At a time when the agricultural industry is facing responsibility for up to 14% of greenhouse gas emissions globally, we as farmers, homesteaders, and gardeners have an opportunity to distinguish ourselves as positive game changers in the climate crisis. For a number of us, that is why we are gathered here today. Many people, like myself, are already taking action to sequester carbon, increase organic matter, and reduce or even eliminate the reliance of fossil fuels on our farms and in our gardens. We are recognizing that our collaboration with the soil leads us to a deeper understanding of our place in the ecosystem. As we are inspired to recognize our interconnectedness and strengthen our community webs, I could not think of a better place to be than with my NOFA Mass community presenting today's keynote speakers. As many of you already know, Paul and Elizabeth Kaiser own and operate a 3-acre no-till diversified farm in Sonoma County, California. Their intensely managed farm grosses more than $100,000 an acre, which is 10 times the average per acre income of comparable California farms, including Sonoma's legendary vineyards. In the last 7 years, the Kaisers and Singing Frogs Farm have been receiving significant attention from journalists, soil scientists, government agencies, and agricultural organizations for their comprehensive regenerative work in the agricultural field. They have received several ecological awards for their remarkable work, including the 2016 Sonoma County Excellence in Local Food Production, the 2016 International Green Institute Hall of Fame Award, the 2015 Pure Farms Pure Water Award, the 2013 Leadership in Sustainability Award, and the 2010 National Pollinator Conservation Award from the USDA. The Kaiser's guiding principles are to disturb the soil as little as possible, keep a diversity of living plants in the ground as often as possible, and keep the soil covered and protected as often as possible. Paul and Elizabeth actualize these practices every day. In addition to their field experience, they bring a wealth of knowledge through their advanced degrees in international relations, natural resource management, sustainable development, and public health. Paul and Elizabeth regularly apply this knowledge on their family's farm and within their community. They beautifully demonstrate the interwoven levels of sustainability through their farming practices, financial stability, and community impact. As an East Coast no-till biointensive farmer, it is now my pleasure and my privilege to welcome to the stage our West Coast colleagues, Paul and Elizabeth Kaiser.
Hello. Great.
And we're on. Good. Wow. Thank you all very much. It's quite an honor to have been invited and be brought out here to the Northeast. I've spent 6-7 years in Connecticut a long time ago, but it's given me the warm fuzzies to be back here. I do enjoy this very much. We in California, I've heard a lot of whispering amongst all of you that California is often a leader in agriculture and a leader in food movement. That may be the case sometimes. But we also hear plenty of whispers from back in California and also this morning from all of you on how much all of you are a powerhouse of innovation out here, and especially for the small, diversified, organic family farm. And that is awesome. And I just want to thank all of you for the work that you're doing. I feel very honored to be up here in front of you.
Yeah. Fantastic. So thank you, Jen, for that wonderful introduction. There are just a couple of things that I'm going to add. And where do we have the flipper?
Sorry.
So I need to look here at my farm.
Sorry.
So this is a picture of our farm from above that was taken last October. You're looking at about 70% of our cropland. So as she said, we've got about 3 acres of production. It's actually a little bit less than that because that includes our compost piles and our greenhouses and everything. The full property is about 8 acres. And in about a month, we're coming up on our 10th anniversary of being on the farm and being Singing Frogs Farm, which we're really excited about. We are in Sonoma County, and you can see around the fringes of the picture, we are bordered on two edges by a 140-acre conventional vineyard, and that is our county. We are wine country. There are a lot of vineyards all around us. Let's see, so we have 3 acres of production. Our background actually is a little bit different. We weren't brought up as farmers. We didn't go to an ag school. We are a generation removed from farming, but we met in West Africa and have our degrees sort of helping farmers from around the outside. So when we came to the property, we started with some ecological principles and then moved into farming. But it was our background from being abroad, from thinking about it from a different perspective, that helped us say, hey, this organic tillage thing isn't working for us. Let's take the tractor out of the picture. Okay, now let's take, you know, the Troy built out of the picture and develop something different. Gross sales she just mentioned, and I think that's about it. We started out as a CSA farm. We were about 100% CSA our first couple of years. At this point, our CSA has grown, but about 40% of our produce goes to the CSA. About 50% goes to farmers markets. We have 2 year-round farmers markets and an additional 3 in the main season. Our CSA is also year-round. And then the last 10% of our produce goes out to restaurants and a wee little bit to a food hub. Almost all of our produce, I would say 95% of our produce, stays within about a 15 or 20 mile radius of our farm, and that feels really good.
And the CSA you mentioned is about 100 to 120 members year round. So it's a good size to manage and get to know everybody without being overwhelmed. So all of you, this is gonna be like basic 101 science, but I like to have a starting platform for all of us to talk about this, and I think it's really important, and I do love numbers and relationships between numbers. So, of course, what is soil organic matter? In fact, what I want you to take from this is the bottom line down there behind Elizabeth. 57% of soil organic matter is carbon. Remember that. Half of your soil organic matter is carbon out there in general. Now, historically, the US has had between 6 and 10% organic matter in its agricultural soils before us humans came in and began cultivating and tilling and plowing and using that land. As we begin to use the land, we degrade the organic matter levels rapidly. In fact, our California Department of Food and Ag, just November a year ago, announced, not so happily, that we now average 1% organic matter in our agricultural soils in California. 1% average. And that's the vegetable breadbasket and fruit and nut breadbasket of the US. We are destroying and raping our soils of their organic matter. So remember what the US used to be before us humans changed that. Here's a nice UNEP map, an older map, of the general soil degradation around the globe. I think the two important notes on this map are, one, there's no category for improved soil, and two, the only places that are non-degraded are the tundras, the deserts, and the jungles, and the places we don't farm, right? So globally, we have already removed about two-thirds of all of the soil-based carbon from our agricultural soils on the planet. That primarily happened in the past century. If we remove two-thirds of our soil carbon in one century, we don't have another century of soil carbon left to keep farming and growing food. And that brings us to tillage, which is one of the major practices that reduces the organic matter level in the soil, from the FAO, Food and Agricultural Organization of the United Nations. I love to see when the UN and the USDA get it. They get the science, they understand it. It's just getting it down to practice and application that's a challenge.
And policy.
So one of the things in this tillage, as we all know, is tillage breaks up your large aggregates in the soil, reducing their soil size, so you have a larger surface area to volume ratio, which means more volatilization of nutrients. A lot of your nitrogen and carbon gets volatilized out of the soil, combines with the oxygen from the tillage in the air to form nitrous oxide and carbon dioxide, two of the most potent greenhouse gases. And yet, as a farmer, the two things you need most in your soil are carbon for soil structure and nitrogen for plant growth. So the very act of tillage is taking the two things that you need most in your soil, removing them, and creating greenhouse gas emissions. In addition, the tillage also physically kills the life in the soil. We can see that quite plainly on the macro scale right behind the plow. There's a whole feast going on of all the earthworms and beetles and grubs and other soil-borne organisms getting devoured by life. And that's not even going into the microscopic scale of the loss of biological life in the soil due to tillage. So another example, besides the volatilization of nutrients or the loss of biology, is also simply just the loss of topsoil. The right-hand side of this chart is, this is a USDA study from late 70s, early 80s. They looked at two different sets of fields, four farms and one that were moldboard plow, four farms that were no-till. This is 40 years ago. They found the moldboard plow fields averaged 4,700 pounds of soil loss per acre per year. And yes, moldboard plows are the most wretched of the tillage equipment, but to give you an idea, that 4,700 pounds per acre per year of soil loss, first of all, it's only about a 14th of an inch. Visually, you couldn't see that. And at that time, 78 to 82, the national average of soil loss was 9,700 pounds per acre per year. So these study samples, they were way below average. They were a good farm. But by comparison, the no-till farms in the same county in Tennessee, same crops, same slope, same soils, the no-till fields were losing 6 pounds of soil per acre per year. 4,700 pounds versus six. That's 700 times more soil loss from the moldboard plow fields than the no-till fields. 700 times more soil loss. And for us in California and the arid West, this is a very important factor. But for every single pass of tillage equipment, it removes about a quarter inch of rainfall equivalent from the soil, in addition to depleting the soil's ability to hold water. As you may know, every percentage point of organic matter you have in the soil increases the ability of an acre of soil to hold up to an additional 18 to 24,000 gallons of water per acre in the top 12 inches for every 1% of organic matter. So if we've gone from an average of 8% organic matter down to 1, we have lost the capacity to hold over 100,000 gallons of plant-available water per acre in the top foot of soil. We've lost that capacity. For the arid West, that is disaster. And finally, I just love this quote because it's a USDA quote. Again, sometimes they get the good science. Tilling the soil is the equivalent of an earthquake, hurricane, tornado, and forest fire occurring simultaneously to the world of soil organisms. Simply stated, tillage is bad for the soil, end quote. That's impressive, and it's true. So, lastly on that, even though tillage in agriculture has removed so much soil carbon and methane and nitrogen and all the other nutrients from the soil, that actually gives us the greatest capacity to put it all back where it belongs. We have the greatest mitigation potential of greenhouse gas emissions, according to an EU-UN combined meta study of over 2,000 different studies, and they found that agriculture has the greatest capacity to mitigate greenhouse gas emissions at the cheapest cost compared to other sectors. In fact, compared to all those sectors combined.
And if you can't see it, the other sectors, there are energy and waste and industry and refrigeration and so forth.
Yeah. So where does that mitigation potential come from in ag? Well, in that same study, 89% of that mitigation potential comes from better soil management. It's not sheep farts and cow farts and rice paddy methane. It's better soil management. It's 89% of that capacity. Because what is it? It's putting all that carbon back in the soil where it belongs. So you all knew that, but I want to come at it with another perspective. And what that brings us to, I should actually change the wording because that wasn't quite right, his quote, but a mere 2 percentage point increase in our soil carbon content can offset 100% of the greenhouse gas emissions that we put out there every year. So we can make significant changes together.
Okay, transition back to our farm. So Jen mentioned some of our principles that we go by, but we actually like to take them from the USDA, again, showing that they are global. It is just soil science. You will see very similar ones in permaculture. But these four principles for managing soil health are what we live by. And I'm going to go through them one by one, but let me just read them all right now. Disturb the soil as little as possible. Grow as many different species of plants as practical. Keep living plants in the soil as often as possible, and keep the soil covered all the time. So disturb the soil as little as possible, don't till. So I can't really tell you what to do here. I'm telling you what not to do here. We have put a picture of Broad Fork because people want to see us doing something. When we first started and we transitioned, I told you we were doing tractor tillage first, and then we created permanent beds where we used a rototiller. Then we took out the rototiller, and this is what we did next. At this point, almost our entire farm, we have not used it. So this is a Broad Fork, for those of you who don't know. We have not used a broad fork in about 4 years. Our soil organic matter is high enough that we don't need to. So we see it as a transition tool, and a lot of the new farmers who are transitioning to no-till or just starting no-till farms find that the broad fork is very useful, and we get ours from Johnny's. We love theirs better than some of the other ones. Okay, the next two we group together. Grow as many different species of plants as practical. So I don't want an acre of broccoli, followed by an acre of broccoli, followed by an acre of broccoli. We have 140 different varieties that we grow, and we're constantly switching them through the same beds. Then the next one, keep living plants in the soil as often as possible. So sort of putting those back in there. So this is the solution, as you all know, you're all very well versed in this, to the problems that Paul was just presenting right now. How are we getting that atmospheric carbon out of the atmosphere and putting it back where we as farmers, we as gardeners need it, okay? So you've got basic photosynthesis. You've got the plants taking sunlight, water, and atmospheric carbon. What are they doing? They're creating glucose, your most basic sugar. Then they're resynthesizing that, number two, into a myriad of various different carbon-based products. More complicated carbohydrates and sugars and amino acids and proteins and waxes and so forth and so on. Now 40% of that they are not using for their own growth and development, but they are pushing out through their roots as an exudate. This is how the carbon is coming from the air and going into the soil, and that is creating your soil organic matter, number four. The carbon in your soil, and therefore feeding the soil food web. I'm not going to go into this because that's not the point of this talk, but feeding the bacteria and the fungi, which then feed everything on up. Okay, so a diversity of plants. These are now pictures from our farm. A diversity of plants in the same space. This is late summer, so you've got a couple rows of pepper plants. This is actually from several years ago. Then you've got some early Brussels sprout plants with either a dill or a fennel in between. I can't even remember. Then you've got some eggplants behind that, and then some plants that are going to go into the winter behind that. Here's another shot. All the everything's planted out. We go from a standing crop to a transplanted crop with 1 or 2 hours in between. Here is another picture, some bok choy followed by some lettuce, lots of other things. So note the 3 to 8 sequential economic crops per bed in a 12-month cycle. So we do farm year-round, and one crop's coming out, the next one is coming in.
Which is what we'll talk about briefly right here. And that actually is one way of keeping the soil covered all the time. That's the whole point in organic ag is cover crops. You don't want to have bare soil all winter or just weeds growing. Put a cover crop in. Keep that soil photosynthesizing and protected and covered and being fed from that sunlight in the plants. So our favorite way to keep it covered is definitely with living green plants, but we also use mulches, et cetera. But that, as I said, is our favorite way to keep things covered. Just dense green growth, photosynthesizing, root exudates, feeding soil biology, keeping the wind and sun off the soil, keeping it moderated and healthy, lots of diversity, lots of bounty, lots of protection of the soil, et cetera. Napa cabbages, bulb fennel. And that is done through transplants, because if you're direct seeding, that seed gets sown, you wait a week, it germinates, a little dicot, then you wait another week or two and it gets a little bigger, and eventually it becomes a transplant-sized plant that can start shading the soil a little bit. Well, we use very large transplants. We grow them all ourselves from our own nurseries. We do our own sowing. And the transplants are an absolute critical component to keeping soil covered and keeping soil being fed through photosynthesis at all times year round. And we can go, so transplants, some of the benefits, and we do love transplants. We direct sow a few things, of course, carrots, radishes, peas, and beans, but everything else is transplants. And part of the reason for that, obviously at less time soil is bare and exposed. Transplants get a second infusion of nutrients. The first infusion is when you sow the seed in your compost mix in the nursery, and then you transplant it into the field where it gets a second infusion of nutrients in a newly prepared bed. And then, of course, if you have low germination rate or even a moderate germination rate, your fields always have 100% crop cover because you're only transplanting out healthy, strong crops. So your fields, if you have a poor germination rate, you have to debate, do I plow it all under and start over, or do I just live with it and have more weeds come in where the seeds didn't germinate? Transplants, you don't have that issue. And of course, if they spend the first month of their life in the nursery, they have less time in the field. Less time in the field means more crops, sequentially per year. It also means less availability to pests. One of our key pest management tools is simply having crops out there less time by having them in the nursery for the first 4 weeks and making them big and strong. And we're not talking little fingerling seedling transplants. These are big, 5-inch, 6-inch tall, robust transplants out of six packs. And then, of course, transplants outcompete weeds and weed seeds, and there's less water to get established, and their most vulnerable stage, just like with our children, is in the nursery where you can protect them and keep them covered and warm and watered and taken care of. And when they get into teenage years, you boot them out and put them out in the fields and let them survive on their own until you can harvest. So a little bit of our seeding. You can see some of these nice kale or broccoli plants getting up there nice and tall and big. Tim's doing our seeding with us. Tim was actually a fellow Peace Corps volunteer in West Africa with us, and now he's been part-time on our farm for the past 9 years doing seeding. And these are some bok choy plants heading out from the nursery to the fields. And the secret that Elizabeth didn't want me to say was those are actually baby bok choy plants. They spend 4 weeks in the nursery and then 4 weeks in the field. They look pretty big already, but they just sort of fatten up in the middle, and the local Japanese restaurant dies for these. They love them, about 60 pounds a week year-round. So some big, tall cucurbits going in, summer squash, and some more kales. And to give you an idea of these three beds in the middle, those were, in the morning of this photograph, those were cauliflower plants that were harvested for our CSA. After the CSA boxes were packed and sent off, we went back out, cleared those beds, put in the lettuce transplants, and then took the photograph at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. So in the morning, we had established cauliflower plants photosynthesizing and protecting the soil. By early afternoon, we have large butterhead lettuces in the same beds, producing the next crop and still photosynthesizing right away.
That looks like about March on our farm.
Yeah. And so here's an example of lettuce beds and cauliflower combined just 3 weeks after transplant. And the cauliflower in this is that big Romanesco plant, the big robust plants, the fractal flowers, the spiraling green plants. We love those, such a good nutty flavor and very creamy and smooth, but they are big plants. So we can only do 2 lines, 24-inch spacing in line for those plants. And when you do a 2-line, 24-inch spacing on those beds and you look down, it's all bare soil afterwards. You're like, man, that's a lot of wasted space and a lot of non-photosynthesizing bare dirt that's getting hot at night, hot in daytime, cold at night. How do I cover and protect that soil? Let's put lettuce in. Do a third line of lettuce on the middle, and then lettuce alternating with cauliflower down the lines. So what do you have? You have 100% cover of cauliflower, a 70% cover of lettuce, gives you 1.7 crops simultaneously. Meanwhile, the lettuce is suppressing weed growth and maintaining higher moisture content in the soil while creating more soil health and more photosynthesis to feed the soil. Then as the cauliflower grows up, it begins to give a little bit of light windbreak and light sunshade to the lettuce, making the lettuce more tender and flavorful. Then the lettuce harvests out just when the cauliflower closes canopy, and you get those two crops in one bed with better soil health in the end and less water to do it, and no weeds.
And when I told you that we do 3 to 8 sequential crops per bed, I'm not counting the fact that he just told you that was 1.7 crops. So we're doing 3 to 7 new sequential crops going through there.
So other examples would be like tomatoes. You know, you just see a single line of tomatoes, and then you wait after transplanting, and you wait as they grow and get bigger until they're finally harvesting fruits. Well, that waiting period's a great time to put escarole, frisée, basil, cilantro, lettuces, anything you want to down the sides. And in fact, like the lettuce here on the right, the red butterhead lettuce, well, this year, you know, we transplant out our first tomatoes in March, and then we begin harvesting by about May 25th or May 30th, and then we usually have our last spring frost around June 10th. So we actually are harvesting tomato fruits before our last spring frost occurs. And these are tomatoes that are outside in the fields, heirloom, dry farm, field-grown tomatoes. But we'd have to cover whenever the frosts come in.
You can see them getting ready for the frost blankets there.
And the lettuces, we had 2 sequential crops of lettuce on the sides, on the shoulders of the tomato beds. Those 2 sequential crops of lettuce gave us $3,000 per 100-foot bed of revenue while the tomatoes grew from transplant to fruiting stage. So while you're waiting for those tomatoes, you're still pulling a lot of revenue out of the beds. Meanwhile, you're protecting the soil, keeping higher moisture content, suppressing weeds, and photosynthesizing to feed the biology. Leeks, another one of those crops that takes 6 months to grow. 6 months is a long time to wait when you got bills to pay. So put a couple lines of mini romaine down the middle of it. Get 2 or 3 sequential crops of lettuce out of the middle of it. It's not a full crop, but it brings in revenue while you wait for those leeks to grow up. Meanwhile, the leeks are giving wind and sun protection to the lettuce, but the lettuce isn't interfering with the leeks at all. Their roots are way down, those leek roots, and they're getting plenty of light. Lettuce doesn't block it. So all kinds of ways to enhance.
So that dual cropping, we don't do that in the wintertime because there's not enough sunlight, but we'll do that spring, summer, and early autumn. And during the summer, almost all of our lettuce production is coming from dual cropped crops like this. Great. Okay, transitioning a bed from one crop to the next. Most of our time on our farm is spent taking one crop out, putting the next one in, and then harvest and harvest and harvest. Taking that crop out, putting in the next crop, and harvest.
Production, not maintenance, production. That's all our employees
do. I'm going to go through this step by step. I don't want to stop on this. Just go next. So the first thing you're going to do is clear the bed. Here, Marty has got some loppers, and we are not pulling out the plants. We are not opening up the soil. We are not taking out the roots and all the rhizosphere that is around that. We are leaving that in the soil, okay? We will pull out some of the weeds, but we're leaving that in the soil, and then all the green mass is going to the compost pile. Then, this is occasional. About once a year, we might lift the pathways onto the bed. Broad fork if you would need. We don't anymore, but we put that in there. And then rake only is needed if you're lifting pathways to, you know, make an even bed top. Then apply organic fertilizers and compost as needed. This isn't done all the time. I would say the organic fertilizers, we do about 70% of the time. Compost, maybe 80% of the time. Right now, we've got our hoop house production going with light greens. We've done three crops. We haven't added anything.
In fact, it was a cucumber crop first all through late summer
that
we put down the compost for the cucumber crop. And since then, we have done no amendments, but we've had three sequential lettuces post-cucumber doing just great.
Next, you're going to transplant?
And child labor always helps. We have two children back home with grandma.
And then watering in the transplants by hand. You can see from the photos we're using drip irrigation on the whole farm. But just to help them get established, we're going to water them in at very least once. But if it's a dry, hot summer, it might be up to 3, 4, 5 days. Then cover the beds as needed. That might be for frost. That might be for insects, whatever's appropriate. Here we've got some bird netting on these, and this is for birds. You can see this, that's an early spring, and we have so much ecology. We have a lot of birds, and they love those little transplants. So,
and then we put together last April a quick little time-lapse video of changing over beds. So I'll just show this to you. It's 45 seconds. This is, I think it was 3 employees, 4 85-foot beds, and about 47 minutes from beginning to end that you're gonna see right here, just to give you an idea of how we do a bed transfer.
So cutting out the crops, you've got the loppers on the left, you've just got harvest knives over on the right.
And it's all feeding our compost pile,
or
piles. We have about 4 to 8 compost piles at any given time on the farm.
Pulling off the irrigation, putting on the organic fertilizers, putting on compost. Because those crops had been there over
winter. That's
about
a quarter to a half inch of compost going down. It looks like more. It's only a quarter to a half inch. It's enough that you can't see the soil underneath. Transplants going in.
And then transplanting right back in. Coffee break.
And you can see on the left, we've got the cauliflower Romanesco with the lettuce intercropped in between. These beds here, it was a different cauliflower with the lettuce in between. And then the right-hand one was the same, actually, all four of them.
Yep.
And then watering in.
Done.
So you can see the ecology around that little patch of 4 beds, 85 foot long. And that was just 3 people for 47 minutes, not even an hour, to remove those 4 beds, prep them, and transplant them, and keep going. So when you talk to our employees, 98% of their labor for the year is transplanting and harvesting, and transplanting and harvesting. It's all production, not maintenance. And back to that beginning and ending of that phase, that represents the carbon in the biology in the soil. You have existing rhizosphere, all the biology around the roots of that crop. When you cut the crop and remove everything above ground, the rhizosphere is untouched and intact. You've never once touched the roots or moved them. And in fact, when you cut out the old crop, those roots won't even begin to die for a couple days. They're still fully alive and exuding for the next day or two until they begin to die. Meanwhile, you've already put in the very next crop that's going to photosynthesize and begin exuding as well. So the rhizosphere never gets harmed. It's always fully alive and functional and always having a constant food source coming in from the atmospheric carbon and sunlight.
So wait, real quick. So the carbon from those plants and the biology from those plants are going to help those plants down there. And we've had a lot of people question us, will you add that compost on the top? You know, it's never mixed in, but it's added to the top. You know, couldn't your soil carbon be increased just by that alone? We've calculated how much carbon and how much soil organic matter is in the compost that's there and our increases in soil organic matter, and it doesn't account for even half of it.
It's all the other maintenance and management aspects and the planning behind it that accounts for the increase in organic matter, not the compost at all. And so our view of it is every single crop out there is a cover crop, and they're all economic. We're not focusing on a summer economic crop and a winter cover crop. We are always cropping. We're always keeping the soil covered. It is all a cover crop, and it's all economic, which we need to make our ends meet as farmers in Sonoma County. And speaking of that year-round, yes, we're California. Yes, we got surfing and sunny skies and beautiful weather and all that. Our particular valley bottom, first of all, we're Northern California, and we're coastal enough that we never warm up, but we're not coastal enough that we stay warm by the ocean. So we actually freeze a lot. As you've already heard me mention, our last spring frost is early June. Our first fall frost can be early or late September. This year it was September 4th and 5th. And we have about 110-day frost-free window in there. And in addition, the past 5 weeks,
That picture about 3 weeks ago or something like that, the Brussels sprout.
That was about 3 weeks ago.
We're just harvesting our Brussels right
now.
You
see our children harvesting eggplant and peppers, wearing wool hats and jackets for those nice tropical summer crops. And then that was a nice deep freeze where we hit about 17 degrees 5 weeks ago. And then
about 10 days ago, wasn't
it? Well, hang on. And then 3.5 weeks ago, we flooded. And then 2.5 weeks ago, we hit 17 degrees again. And then a week and a half ago, we flooded again. And then, you get the point. We've been frost flood, or actually deep freeze flood, et cetera. So we're not exactly the best of growing climates in our valley bottom. Our competing farmer friends in the county don't even have a clue what we're going through. They're hitting maybe 32 or 31 degrees as they're low.
And we really think that our soil organic matter and our positive biology helps us through that. And so the results of the system, there are two major results. One of them is in soil carbon, and the other one is in profit. So I'm going to talk about the soil carbon one. So when we started farming, you can see organic tillage here. Not doing that well, very gray soil. You've got just some direct seeded peas in there. Our soil organic matter was 2.4%. These days, ever since we've been doing the no-till or a couple years after we started, it's been 8 to 11%. Now remember the USDA stats that said that pre-agricultural fertile land in the United States used to be 6 to 10%. I don't think we have actually gone above the 11%. We've gone up to 14%. We didn't see any added benefit. We sort of let it slide back a little bit. We think that that 6 to 10% is sort of your ideal place to be growing. Mother Nature knew something. Go figure.
Yeah. And we do test down 6 to 12 inches deep. So we're not testing anywhere near where we're putting compost on. We're testing way below that in the root growing zone. Which we get a lot of flack from soil scientists for because they want us testing the top 6 inches, and I just don't believe that because that's not where the roots are. In a tillage system, that's where the roots are, but we don't have a hard pan. You can bring a 4-foot soil probe and lean on it and go all the way down 4 feet, no issue.
And we've also done soil tests going all the way down to 3 feet.
So the average gross revenue per crop acre per year, this is the other meat and potatoes of all what's going on besides the ecology and the soil and climate change, is for all California vegetable farms, the average annual gross per acre per year is only about 2,000, a little less. And when you look at the organic veg farms, you're up to almost 4,000, $3,700 per acre per year. And then you get to all of us, the California small, diversified, family farm, direct market farms, and their revenues per acre per year are about $11,000 or $12,000. So they're doing much better, obviously, than the big ag, which is great. Per acre per year. And that's actually equivalent to Sonoma County vineyards. The average vineyard is about 11,000. The best vineyards are about 20,000 per acre per year, 24,000 per acre per year. And economic viability for small-scale diversified family farms in California is considered to be about 14,000 per crop acre per year or better, which means a lot of people just aren't making it. They're homesteading, they're gardening, and they're kind of losing money, but they're enjoying it, and it's a good thing. But there are those who are doing, like our competitors, the market, our friends, they're all doing sort of that 15,000 to 25,000 per crop acre per year with the organic tillage systems. And that's great. It means they're making it, and they're also competing with us. And then we have a couple of local ag schools, our JC, the Junior College, Schoen Farm, and UC Davis, and those are both in that same range of 15,000 to 20,000. And as we've already mentioned, we're up about $100,000, $105,000 per crop acre per year in gross revenue.
And that's the last 4 years.
While building soil, using less water to do it, and keeping all of our food within 15 miles.
Yeah.
And employing our people year-round.
So this is our farm family. You can see Paul and I and our two kids in there, but also a slew of other people. We have about 5 to 6 full-time equivalents, but that's a lot of extra part-time, and there's a couple of interns there as well. So important to have that whole family of people, and important to pay them well. Our cost of living in Sonoma County is rather high, as we hear it is out here as well.
And since we're not seasonal, they are also not seasonal. They are permanently employed, and they have job security. And that's absolutely critical, because it's not just about the farmers, it's the farm employees and the communities that we feed, as you all know. So.
Okay.
I love this picture of Nina. She's great.
Yeah, this is great. Nina's actually, she just texted me a minute ago. She's selling at our local farmers market as we speak right now, one of our year-round farmers markets.
She also has a master's in soil science from Berkeley.
Yeah, she's a smartie. Tenets of Singing Frog's farming model. So we see there's really 3 points, and we've really talked about 2 of them here, being no-till and being intensive. We've sort of skipped around the ecological. Our workshop series, we really focused on the ecological this morning, but just to touch on it a little bit more here, because it's so important to rounding it out.
Hedgerows, hedgerows, hedgerows. We love them. They absolutely are great for our beneficial insects and all of our predators and pest control, like snakes and praying mantids and lacewings and lady beetles and all those, but they also are beneficial for things like our windbreaks and frost protection. A hedgerow like this that's sort of 5-6 feet high can give up to 3 degrees of frost protection up to 20 feet to the side of the hedgerow. So the hedgerow doesn't need to be over the crops, it just needs to be next to it to create some climatic stability to help reduce frosts in the winter and help reduce the stress of heat waves in the summer. So next to a hedgerow, it's always cooler on those hot days and it's warmer on those cold nights. And then this kind of hedgerow picture, 20 feet to the left is that 140-acre conventional vineyard. 30 feet to the right is one of our fields. But you can't tell that. And some of our other inhabitants of our 7 ponds in our fields, that upper right picture, that's a quarter next to the baby turtle.
These are both in our roadways, just walking around. And besides these, we have all sorts of other animals, everything from bobcats and coyotes and owls and birds and so forth.
And we also do a whole lot of outreach, which is kind of why we're here, is because we enjoy getting more people to be successful, viable farmers that also have the ecological bent. So often it's either you're ecological or you're profitable. And we want farmers to be both, for sure. So we spend a lot of time doing on-farm workshops. We have between 600 and 1,000 people come through the farm each year on farm tours. And we also do a lot of outreach and a lot of conferences.
If perchance you're a long ways away, but if anybody wants to come out for a workshop, go on our website and get on our email list, because we'll be doing more of them this spring, 2-day workshops where we get our hands in the soil and practice some of these things.
These are some farms that we are familiar with, and we've actually either visited them or they visited us, or we've trained them and got them up and running. And these are farms mostly out west, not all.
This is in Carbondale, Colorado at 6,000 feet elevation. These guys are doing, it's a couple and they have 3/4 acre, very profitable and just starting to do carbon farming. This was in Durango, Colorado, different part of Colorado, 7,000 feet elevation. He's only a year old. Check out all those beds back there just getting ready for production.
I'm so excited for him.
It.
I want to grow in those
Daniel
beds.
Fulmer.
That's awesome.
These are our friends. They've been doing it the longest, Hillview Farm in Auburn, Colorado, California, that are at about 2 to 3,000 feet elevation. This is gonna be their 4th year. They go year-round. In their 2nd year of production, 12 months of production, he doing full-time on the farm. She had a part-time job and did some of the marketing on 3/4 acre just around his parents' house. They pulled in $96,000, just the two of them.
Their second year part-time. Ever farming.
And then this is another small farm, another couple in our community. Also, they do just under an acre.
And Singing Frogs Farm again. And questions? We're it.
Awesome. So if you guys would like to select, we'll do a round of questions now if you'd like to ask some questions, and you guys can select who you see out there, and I'll bring the mic to you.
Sorry, I surprised you with that ending. That was abrupt. You didn't see it coming. I see a question over here.
Up to what scale do you work under a farm's
Told you, Jason, first question would be scale. Good question, too. It's an excellent question, because we need the world to be doing things like this, right? So that scale question, the question is about scale. Up to what scale can we be doing this kind of farming? First of all, many of our friends slash competitors in our community are on the 15 to 30 acre scale already, and they're doing organic tillage. Their gross revenue is the same as our gross revenue from 3 acres, and they're on 15 to 30 acres, and their profit is usually quite a bit less than our profit. So our profit is often greater per acre than their revenue per acre, than their gross per acre. And so when we talk about scale, we have to realize that this 3-acre farm is a mighty farm. It is producing a lot of food from 3 acres. So don't think of it as a 3-acre farm. So what we need is not a 100-acre version of this 100 miles away from San Francisco and a lot of transportation and driving back and forth. We need 100 3-acre farms like this right in San Francisco. And so we need so much more food. Yeah, I mean, you get it. We need the food grown in the communities that eat it and that will work that farm and work that land and then cut out the transportation, cut out the fossil fuels, and start investing in ourselves and our own resiliency, for sure. So that's how we view scaling up, is more of this, not larger of this.
Could you do it? Yes, you could do it. Do we personally want to do it? No, we do not personally want to do it. It would be a lot of management, but you could do it.
Right here.
Do we ever use a traditional cover crop, or do we always just crop? We have one very specific place where we're doing a cover crop, and those are the fields way down at the bottom, because you saw the picture of our flood. We flood down there every year, and I can't have a crop that I'm harvesting for food safety reasons down there. So we'll have our last crops that we can harvest early December, and we'll do a quick cover crop down there just to keep something growing in the soil. Otherwise, we wouldn't. So that's a specific situation.
Every crop's a cover crop, and they're all economic. This is really, the question is about drought resilience with this system. And in fact, this system is ideal for drought conditions because it is so much more resilient against the impacts of drought and the effects of drought. So we first began learning a lot of the principles behind this in sub-Saharan Africa, working in agroforestry with other farmers where they were already working on the edge of the desert, places that had been forested 40 years earlier and the forest had been cut down, and now they're working on sand and laterite without any soil or any organic matter. And so how do you bring back some modicum of soil to actually grow food in and have nutrient density? So this system really is ideally suited for drought areas, though it works anywhere because it is simply soil science, and that is universal. Do we have any perennial or woody crops? We do a lot of fruit trees, and a lot of our hedgerows have economic crops within them, and we do a lot of perennial herbs and some perennial flowers, and we have a wood lot that we like to grow for eventual timbers and stuff. So some. In my agroforestry days before this, I had a lot more. That's my love, is the perennial stuff. But temperate zone, a little bit different than tropical, and I was so spoiled growing in the tropics that it's hard for me to adjust to temperate zone because things grow slowly in the temperate zone. So.
When we said we stopped and slowed down, we cut back our, his question was, I said that our soil organic matter on our farm is 8 to 11%, and we think that that 6 to 10% is sort of a sweet spot that Mother Nature knew what she was doing. And what would happen if we went up and above that is the question. So we let it come back. We just stopped composting those beds for quite a while.
We also walked on them, kind of compacted them.
We did, actually.
Not abuse them, but you know, just sort of treat it like dirt more than like soil. So, yeah. And definitely grew a lot more dense crops and really kind of, you can grab that mic too.
Oh, super. We're not doing that.
without the mic. So yeah, we just, to let it come back down and just not be quite as intense about it, because we wanted to really get some more bulk density and more compaction in there. It was just too light and too fluffy. So, and we found that up to 13-14% organic matter in the top 6 to 12 inch layer of soil, we didn't see any added benefit, and we possibly even saw a little bit of drawback. It seemed to be just too light and too fluffy and too aerated, and we like that 8 to 10, 8 to 11% range.
So that's the negative that we saw, that sort of too light and too fluffy. We have had some organic consultants come out and be very fearful that our system might be causing some sort of runoff or something like that. So that is one possibility. Honestly, there are also studies that show that as you have increased soil organic matter, you're able to hold that nitrogen better. Well, and so it's really the input substitution farming where you're going to have that problem of having runoff. And we've tested our water. We've tested our water running onto the farm, coming out of our wells, and running off the farm to show that we don't have any nitrogen running off. In fact, we're cleaning the water. We have a neighbor up the hill of us who's growing pot, and a little bit of nitrogen comes onto our fields, and the water that's leaving our fields has undetectable. And in terms of phosphorus, what's coming on and what's leaving is identical. So there's just some slight concerns as we're all learning the science here, and we saw that it was too light and fluffy.
So we've had a few soil scientists who say, you put that much compost on a field and you're going to absolutely create the runoff. But they're thinking in that tillage box of having soil that's only 2% organic matter, and then you till in that compost, and they say that's just too much. And they're right. In those conditions, it's too much. But surface applied, untilled, already high organic matter level soil, it can hold all that. It becomes an amazing sponge. So I think
Two more questions. I don't know. Right here. We go year round so we don't take the winter break. We make a point to not work more than 40, maybe 50. You say 40, it really turns out to be 50 hours a week. And so that really helps. Also, having two kids really pulls you away from it to make you focus on something else. So you definitely have to take care of yourself and find whatever that is. For me, that's a Pilates class twice a week.
Zumba. I love Zumba.
You didn't expect that out of this talk.
We also, actually, that same 40 to 50 hours a week goes for our crew, our farm crew.
Yes.
All of our employees, I think we have one or two that'll work about 44 hours a week. Everybody else is under 40 hours a week. Everybody. Nobody's going for burnout here. We're all going for a constant, balanced life where we have other things we do outside the farm and we enjoy our time.
We have a rich,
full life. And so we get our vacations. We get away. You saw that picture of our farm crew and how big it is. Having that large of a farm family means that we can take vacations because they will cover for us. They can take vacations because we'll cover for them. So we have this really large pool of people that keep things going so that nobody burns out and everybody can have what they need to make things work.
That said, our first couple of years, we did not have 40 or 50 hour weeks like many of you here. And we did have a little burnout, so we learned. Over there, last question.
How do we deal with pathways? Come to our afternoon session, the third session. Pathways, there's lots of ways to manage them.
You can see here a couple of ways. One of them is straw. One of them is using a landscape fabric.
The little beads of straw there, those are actually little flakes every 20 feet in pathways that are sloped uphill, downhill. So we're standing on the upslope, looking downslope, and some fields are going across the slope like they should, and some fields are going up and downslope like they shouldn't, right? But we've actually found that when those fields were across the slope, as it turns out, this whole roadway, we put that road in because that road happens to be a natural seep where water comes out and makes the ground really wet. So when it rains, water can't go in there, water's just coming out. And so what happens is the fields directly below the seep become waterlogged, and when we had the beds going across on the contour, the water would back up behind the beds and eventually would break through the beds and create gully erosion cascading through 10 or 15 beds on down to the hoop houses. So we spent an entire winter turning the entire fields 90 degrees and rebuilding the fields. And we have the up and down pathways now, but there's a green grass road, there's a green grass path, there's another green grass road, then there's a whole series of swales and natural areas. So we're catching any runoff that happens, and then those straw flakes are in the bare dirt pathways every 20 feet on the slope. So what we found is Way down here is a seasonal pond and another seasonal pond, and they exit off the property over there. And those seasonal ponds catch all the water because about 3 feet down, or between 1 and 3 feet down, we have a clay layer. So all the water goes down and then goes to those ponds. We found in the first couple of years, the intention of those ponds by the prior owner was to scoop out any erosion sediment and put it back in the fields. In the first couple of years when we were doing tillage, we were scooping out erosion sediment from those seasonal ponds and putting it back in the fields. And then we switched to no-till, and we started having permanent cover, permanent grass roadways, permanent grass pathways, permanent beds. We haven't scooped out those ponds of erosion sediment in 7 years. There's no erosion going to them anymore.
Well, and I'm going to add to that, our first couple of years, those ponds would fill up. They're seasonal ponds, so since we have the rainy winter, in the summer, they would dry out. They dry out every year. And our first several years, they would fill up after we had only about 4, 5, 6 inches of rain. The last few years, it's been far more rain. It's been into January before we fill that up. So that just means that the rain that is falling on the fields is staying there and it's seeping in. And after we have a large rain event on our farm, it's actually pretty incredible afterwards because you can just hear it percolating into the soil.
It's a beautiful sound, too.
It is a beautiful sound. It's just this sound. And I just wanted to add one quick other thing, the pathway question. I had for a really long time been wanting to put something green in the pathways, like a low-growing clover. We debated that for a long time. I was really pushing it. Paul and John and actually Marty, too, were like, oh, my gosh, it's going to grow into the beds. What are we going to do? That's fine for taller crops like broccolis, but what about lettuces? It's going to be a nightmare. I was finally convinced because we talked to a farmer in Oregon that had done that, and she said a huge percentage of her time was spent trying to get the alfalfa out of her fields, and she had devised this big knife.
Getting the clover.
What did I say? Did I say alfalfa? I meant
clover. Out of her beds back in the pathways, so she had a big knife to just sort of guillotine the edges of the pathways to keep that clover out of the beds and in the paths. So it ended up being a lot of management.
It did. So we end up doing cover on that soil more through mulches than through green living plants. I wish it were green. Okay, that's it.
We are done. Thank you.
No problem. Thank you very much. Thank you very, very, very much.